Hi, I'm Laurence Layne, and we're in Healing Waters Clinic, which is my office and clinic in St. Augustine, Florida. And we're here today to talk about repetitive motion and stretching to prevent injury and self-care for muscular injuries. So I thought we would just keep it as simple as possible and be as non-technical and talk a little bit about what people think and may be true or what may not be true. Many times I've found that the what people think of as a medical diagnosis for musculoskeletal injuries, while they may be accurate at some level, don't provide good solutions for solving problems in healthcare. And what we're talking about specifically today is repetitive motion strain for the arms and the wrists, elbows, hands, things like that. And this could be for anyone who is using their hands and arms a lot, but also particularly for the purposes of this video, people that do interpretation, sign language. So what we're going to cover is some ideas so that you can understand the basics of what the problem is and why you or someone you know may have an injury or pain in their hands or arms, and also to see what to do to prevent such problems and such injuries, and also to treat yourself at home, if we can use that word in a very liberal way, in the sense that you may need professional help, such as therapists, but we'll talk about it as home therapy. So first of all, many times what's called carpal tunnel syndrome or thoracic outlet syndrome and various other, you know, hand pains golfer's elbow, tennis elbow, rotator cuff strain or tear. Those are often names that are attached to various injuries when people go see a doctor or a therapist. And often that's used as a diagnosis. Many times these are what you call very general terms that are applied. And the implication of by naming these things, naming these conditions, is that that's what it is, and there's a certain way to treat that. And if we treat that a certain way, we're talking medically speaking, then that's the end of the story. If it doesn't get better, there's no other recourse except for surgery. So if it doesn't respond to some kind of therapy, physical therapy sometimes, then people have either medication, such as anti-inflammatories or painkillers, and then if those don't work, surgery. And in my experience, because I've worked with various forms of alternative healing, sometimes called complementary and alternative medicine, or CAM, I'm familiar with a wide range of therapies and modalities and things besides just medical treatment. So what we're talking about here today is not simply something in the alternative field that someone may or may not have tried, but actually things that I'm familiar with in the clinic and that actually work on real people. And so we're going to cover a little bit today the challenges that are inherent in seeing a doctor or a therapist who has a certain way of looking at things, and then also incorporating alternative ideas, some of which may be very beneficial and some may not. So, first of all, most pain comes from musculoskeletal problems. And most of the time, most doctors are not going to break it down for you like that. And most musculoskeletal problems happen because of strain or tightening of muscles. And what we call repetitive strain and spasm. And it's not simple things where we go out into the yard, for instance, and do a little yard work or a little gardening, and we have a sore shoulder or a sore neck, and we massage it or put on a little bit of liniment or something like that, and it's better in a few days. We're talking about conditions where people have used their body repetitively, sometimes for many years, doing the same activities over and over and over again. Not only are the muscles spastic, but the nerves are irritated, constantly firing in what's called a pathological reflex loop into the tissues and then firing back to the spine, where there's just constant irritation and muscles are under constant tension and shortening. So that muscles and other soft tissues actually shorten mechanically. They lose their ability to lengthen. And this is one of the key factors in you getting well and preventing injury for the future. I'd like to talk a little bit about how muscles shorten. We just began talking about where muscles lose their ability to lengthen. And I'm going to hold my hand up here and show you muscular action. So I'm clenching my fist or bending my wrist. Well, a muscle has to shorten for this action to take place. At the same time, the muscles that are opposite on this side of my wrist have to lengthen. Okay, so there's always a muscle that contracts. There's always a muscle that relaxes. And to go in the opposite direction, this side must tighten and this side must lengthen. So our whole body is built like that. And the places where the body bends, we call them joints. That includes the spine and the jaw bones, what we call the TMJ joint, temporal mandibular joint, the neck, where we rotate our neck. All of these are joints, movable parts, and they're all moved by soft tissues. Soft tissues, besides being muscles, are ligaments, tendons, and connective tissue, or fascia. And fascia is kind of like, to paint a picture for you, if you ever take the skin of your arm and roll it, it kind of maybe crackles a little bit, you can feel something underneath the skin. Or if you ever pull the skin off of a chicken and there's some white material in between the skin and the flesh, that's kind of like what fascia is. It kind of holds things together. It wraps around everything in the body, all the muscles, all the organs, the brain, the spinal cord. And fascia shortens. In fact, most of us know about fascia because fascia gets tight and surrounds the muscles, and that's what causes wrinkles, kind of lays down tracks. And we're very familiar with that part of it. And these soft tissues become shortened over time, which then, if we have one of these joints here, for instance, my finger, this becomes compressed at some level. It starts to lose range of motion. It becomes tight. Sometimes there's a buildup of material around the joint, and that's when they call it arthritis. Now, in my opinion, I believe that most of this can be prevented and cared for, and particularly when people are in pain, that a lot of it can be completely ended. Now, it's not everybody's experience, because everyone hasn't tried, what we might call massage and manual therapy and manipulation. Those are some of the forms of alternative healing we're talking about today. And we'll talk a little bit about that later, but I really want to get you into how the muscles work and what to begin to do to prevent pain. Now, over time, these tissues become tightened, and not merely a spasm, as I say, something that you can perhaps massage out or put a hot application on or take an anti-inflammatory pill, which many people do. We're talking about things that over time build up and literally shorten and contract mechanically. In other words, the length of the actual tissue is changed. And those things often take a lot of time to heal. So I want you to understand that even though we're going to cover some stretching today and a little bit of strengthening, that some things are severely shortened and take a lot longer and may need the assistance of a therapist or some other healer. So let's talk about range of motion a little bit. I'm going to raise my arm here. Now, there's some people that can't raise their arm beyond that level. They can't raise their arm here. Here's a normal range of motion beside the head. Okay, if I was to straighten my arm out, I should be able to move my hand out, and that's a normal range of motion. Now, some of you can't raise your arm above your head, and that's an abnormal range of motion. And most of the time, that the reason that happens is because of shortened, contracted soft tissues. Some things that over time that have helped most people are stretching. I know that people, for instance, do swimming and activities in the water, exercises, for instance, arthritis classes and what have you. All of those are good things, and that some people feel like they can go to the gym and work things out, or they can walk it off, or they can get a shot, maybe in a joint, like a cortisone shot or something. But these things are not effective for everybody. And the single most important factor I found for maintaining health of the musculoskeletal system is stretching. Awareness of your range of motion and increasing the flexibility in your muscles. This is often ignored in most fitness trainings, and when people talk about fitness, they're often talking about strength training and sometimes cardiovascular training, particularly at gyms. And then flexibility is usually a third component that is often ignored or de-emphasized. So I'd say that for many people, particularly as they're getting older, that stretching and flexibility is perhaps the biggest part of fitness that should be part of their program or their life, particularly if they do activities or have vocations where they use their hands and arms, such as interpreters. I should also mention that many times when people are attempting to rehabilitate themselves, whether it's at the gym or through a physical therapist doing exercise or a massage therapist or someone who teaches them exercises or what have you, chiropractor, whoever person goes to, is that exercises mean a lot of different things to people. And I've been talking about flexibility, and I'll often have people ask me, well, I go to the gym and I lift weights. Isn't that creating flexibility in my muscles? Actually, I'm lifting the arms over my head, and I'm lifting my legs and straightening my legs and twisting my spine. And those are actually exercises. Those are not stretches. A stretch is a static movement. I'm going to use my arm and bring it behind me like that. I'm holding it in place. I'm stretching my pectoral muscles and my biceps muscles. That is actually what a stretch is. If I had a weight and I was moving repetitively back and forth like this, strengthen that pectoral muscle and that biceps, then it would not be a stretch. That would be an exercise or a strengthening exercise. If one is holding the limb or the body part in a static way, stretching it, then you are lengthening the tissues. If you're doing any kind of motion, whether you're using the body weight or like a dumbbell or a weight, then you're actually recruiting the muscles. They're firing, and you're creating a different kind of exercise, which is not necessarily stretching. So that's why people often have problems when they go to the gym or they're working with a traditional therapist, like a physical therapist, where they've been taught things to strengthen. Now, sometimes those are good and sometimes those work because they stabilize joints that are weak. But most of the time, I have found that most pain comes from short and contracted tissues around joints, not necessarily because they're unstable. If that was not true, I think that many more people would get well going to the gym and traditional physical therapy and traditional orthopedic medicine. That model's changing, however. All of those fields are changing, and they're moving towards doing more flexibility and stretching. For instance, people are doing much more yoga in gyms these days. It's become a very popular fitness routine. One of the reasons is, besides making you feel good, it lengthens tissues. And we all need that, no matter what kind of fitness program we have. Now we're going to talk a little bit more about torn rotator cuff, carpal tunnel. I'm going to hold my arm up. This is where the carpal tunnel is. a little band here, and they often go in there and surgically snip it or ream it out. Most of the problems are coming down here from the muscles in the forearm. So we're going to actually learn how to stretch those today. If you put your hand on your arm and move your fist like this, you'll feel the muscles down here around your elbow moving. So here's where the problem is. Here's where the cause is. And that's what we want to get into, is looking for what the cause is and not just the effect. And unfortunately, much of medicine treats the effects and not the causes. Many times when people have what's called a torn rotator cuff, it's really something more like a frozen shoulder. That word is tossed around a lot. And even though sometimes the doctor with some kind of MRI or CAT scan or x-ray can see a tear in a muscle, it's not completely torn. And many times these problems can be repaired with therapy and stretching. Sometimes it takes a while to repair them, many weeks or months but it certainly is preferable to surgery. And as you may know, that surgery is not always successful for such things, even though we're glad when it is successful. I think most people prefer a more conservative treatment. Just so you know that such things can be worked with through therapy and stretching, and you can do a lot of the work yourself at home. So now let's go ahead and look at a few basic stretches. Now we're on to some practical aspects of stretching. I remember a while ago I was saying that when we move our hand or our part of our body, that this part is lengthening. This is the part that is stretching. Okay? So now stretches should not hurt. A lot of people press or pull as hard as they can, and that's not the object of this. So when I take my hand, put it on my head, and pull my head to my left shoulder, I'm actually stretching the right side of my neck. This is where I should feel the stretch. Sometimes people will feel things on the opposite side of what's being stretched. And that, in fact, is where the muscle is tightening. But that's where people will feel it, because the joint is really too tight. Now, this is where we want to feel the stretch. And you see how long I'm doing this stretch. I'm doing it for about 5 to 10 seconds. I'm going to go the other direction. I'm going to stretch the left side of my neck by pulling my head down to my right shoulder. Now, there are different kinds of stretching technologies, and we're just using basic stretching today. There's all kinds of ways to stretch. These are the things that I teach my clients in the office, which are very basic, because that's what most people need to do. They need basic forms of stretching, which alleviate most problems. Some people have stubborn problems or unusual problems, we use other forms of stretching. Those are a little bit technical and we won't get into them today. However, everything that we're showing you on this DVD tape should help the average person and help keep you injury free for a long time. So we've just covered a lateral neck stretch. I'm stretching my right neck. Now you always use your hands or some other way to stretch. We don't just bring our body part over like this. That's okay, but we're really using these muscles over here. But if we're doing this, we're also adding a little bit more pressure. It takes all the energy out of this side and stretches this more effectively. So you'll often see that in books where people are raising their leg or what have you, and I prefer using a rope or something to support that leg, because I don't think you're getting an adequate stretch. So let's look at another neck stretch here. We just did a lateral neck stretch to either side. Now we're going to do a back of the neck stretch called a posterior neck stretch, where I'm going to put my hands behind my head and I'm gently going to pull my head forward. This is done without any pain. If any of this hurts, you should not do it. Okay, and I'm just going to hold this for a little while. This feels good. It also stretches down to the middle of the back. And now I'm going to stretch the front of the neck. I always give a moment in between each stretch. I'm going to take my fingers and gently put them under my chin. And I'm going to let my head tilt backwards and gently stretch the front of my neck. This is not a forceful stretch, which is very easy. Okay, now if if this bothers you, don't do it. As you'll often see in disclaimers, talk to your doctor before starting an exercise program. Well, often, the reason for that really is if someone has major health problems, they do want to be careful. So this tape is designed for the average person who has average health and is looking to increase their health and increase their flexibility. So truly, if you have any major health concerns, you should talk to health professionals, ideally a therapist or a doctor who understands musculoskeletal health and can tell you what you should, what may be too much for you to do. Okay, now we're going to bring in a model here and we're going to do a few more neck stretches. All right, our model Maureen is going to help us with some other stretches here. If you'll do pull your head to the right, Maureen, just going to pull your head laterally to the right, and you're going to rotate your head down and hold that stretch for a little while. That stretches the muscles on the back of the neck also, but some other lateral muscles that elevate the scapula and the shoulder blade and what we call the trapezius, a stretch for that. And very effective. Okay, now you're going to go the other direction. You're going to tilt your head to the opposite side. And one thing that we're covering in this tape is that we're covering all kinds of different muscles. So we're going to put the body in different positions that more effectively stretch the muscles. And now we're going to laterally rotate the neck again. Then you're going to look up to the opposite side. And that's going to stretch muscles in the front of the neck, which are very important, particularly for those of us that use computers and look down a lot on paperwork or that hold our arms in front of us. Okay, let's go to the opposite side. You're going to pull your head to the left. Then you're going to rotate your head up. A little tight. So we're holding these anywhere from the average of 5 to 10 seconds, and that's where I think would be a good amount of time. We're now going to cover some shoulder stretches. The front of the shoulder gets tight on most people. For instance, I'm holding my arms in front of me. Most people have to drive, and if you're doing sign language interpretation, this is going to be a very tight area right here in the front of the shoulder. Now, one of the simplest stretches is to merely bring your arms behind you like this, to stretch the pectoral muscles. And you can do this when you're working on the computer, and I'm holding it for a few seconds here, and you should be able to feel it stretching in the front of your chest. Now, a lot of people do strengthening exercises at the gym where they're using weights to bring, to tighten these muscles and various things like that. And that's okay, except what you'll see is people as they get older, people do too much strengthening of their pectoral muscles, you'll see their shoulders start to rotate inward. Some of you may observe that there are people that you see their shoulders. That's because these pectoral muscles are getting tight here. And this is the way you stretch that. It's very simple. We'll try to cover at least one more stretch for the pectorals. It also helps what we call the hump in the back, sometimes called the Dowager's hump. People are always trying to stand up straight, but what happens is the muscles in the front of their chest and the front of their neck get tight. There is something you can do about that, and we're going to cover some of that. So now I'm going to show you a lateral shoulder stretch. The lateral shoulder here, I'm going to turn and show you what I'm going to put my arm behind my back. I'm going to turn around and show you where that is. And I'm going to take my other hand and pull it to the opposite direction. So my right arm is behind my back, and now I'm going to pull to the left, grasp my wrist, and gently pull it. That stretches the front of the shoulder and the lateral shoulder. And it's very important to get that area stretched. It feels really good, by the way. I'm going to change hands and do the other side, something like this. Now, these are some of my pet stretches. I can tell you that All of this seems very simple, and this is meant to be an informal time together. This isn't supposed to be the latest scientific theories explained. There's plenty of that. We're not going to go into our textbooks, and this is meant for just regular people to grasp the essentials, the basics, and just out of pain. Now, these things really work. They look very simple, but I can tell you that if you do them, you will get results. Now, that doesn't mean that you might not have a restriction in a joint where you might need some therapy or some other type of thing like hot packs or manipulation on a joint, something like that, to get mobility. But given the normal person trying to stay out of pain through repetitive motion, these are very effective. So let's move on to another stretch. Okay, we're going to stretch the back side of the shoulder and the underside of the shoulder. And for that, you'll raise your elbow up and put it behind you like that. And you take your other hand and pull on the elbow, pulling backwards. And with a gentle stretch, you don't want to hurt yourself. Some of you may not be able to do this, which indicates that you have limited range of motion. However, do the best you can. And if it hurts, then you don't want to do that. So you want to do that on both sides. This stretches the triceps muscle and underneath what we think of as the armpit, the muscles that actually go down into the back and partly into the back of the shoulder blade too. So now we're going to stretch across the body. We're going to pull our arm across the body and put your hand on your elbow and stretch to the opposite side. Now this stretches the back of the shoulder blade, the back of the shoulder. And this is very effective for a lot of strains. Now, there are some of you that won't be able to do this because you may find that it's painful or it pulls or catches, and that's okay. You're gonna have to adopt and adapt a simpler form of that or less intense form of that, and you may need some therapy or manipulation to mobilize that shoulder. Now we're going to do some stretches for the jaw and the facial muscles, also known as the temporomandibular joint. So take the pads of your fingers or the top part of your palm and put them underneath your cheekbones. There you go. And you're going to slowly pull downward. And you're tractioning the muscles in your face. And it's a very good feeling. Most people find it very it relaxes their whole body, and it certainly relaxes their jaw. We carry around a lot of tension in our jaws. They're certainly associated with our neck. And of course, that's what we do in our physical bodies is we often tighten. Okay, we're just gonna hold that for another few seconds. This is a myofascial stretch, very effective. Okay, so now we're gonna massage and stretch some of the muscles under our jaw. You can take your fingers or your thumbs. And you're going to gently start under the corner of your jaw and very gently pull the muscles towards your chin. This should not hurt. You're not going to hurt anything if you're on the muscles. Very gently pulling forward and so that you get a nice gentle stretch through that. You can use your index finger, you can use your thumbs. And it just generally loosens the facial muscles and the muscles of the front of the neck. Now we're going to do some more front of the neck stretches. Here's one where we put our hands on our sternum, our upper chest, and then we're going to kind of look up at the ceiling and tilt our head backwards as far as we can comfortably. Now some people can't do this because it makes them dizzy. So if this bothers you, you don't want to do this very often, or you want to do it very easily and not tilt your head too far back. Sometimes people wonder whether the mouth should be open or closed. Let's just say that it's lightly closed with your teeth parted but your lips together. That seems to be a very comfortable way to do this. You can also open your mouth if it feels more comfortable that way. Well, that was fun. Okay, so we're going to do some more neck stretching here for the front of the neck. Okay, so with this stretch, what I'll do is I'll put my arm, my palm, on my chest, and I'm going to take my other hand, where my face and gently pull the opposite direction. At first, this may seem a little awkward, but after a while, after you do it, it feels very good. So I'm just going to hold this for a few seconds just to give you an idea. And then I'm going to go the opposite direction, something like this. Now that little bit should not hurt. We're just doing very general stretches. And once again, if any of them hurt, you know, adapt it, adopt it. Don't do it if you don't know what's happening. Now we're going to do some forearm and wrist stretching. Hold your arm out in front of you, and then you're going to bend your hand downward and pull with your other hand. This is called flexion. The key here is to keep the elbow straight. That's what's going to allow you to stretch the forearm muscles effectively. And this should not be uncomfortable, even though some people have very tight wrists. You want to be careful that it's not painful. Now we're going to repeat that with the other side. And actually, after you do this, it should feel very good. You're just really doing it for 5 to 10 seconds each time. Now we're going to reverse that and still extending the arm and pulling the hand up the opposite direction. That's called extension. Okay. And once again, the elbows should be straight and the fingers should be straight and moderate pressure, but not pulling real hard. And that makes the arms and the wrist feel very good. Now for some fun, as if we haven't had fun before. We're going to do some TMJ, or jaw exercises, and some eye movements. Now, why we do this is because the eyes and the muscles around the eyes and the muscles around the jaw are very connected to our neck and our nervous system. There are so many nerves that come out of the base of the skull and around the neck. The cervical nerves are very involved with how the head sits on the neck and how everything operates, and our whole posture and our whole sense of balance, actually. So everything that we're doing, believe it or not, even though we're talking about repetitive motion for the upper body, we're really talking about also helping balance throughout the whole body. And I know people do a lot of rehabilitation by working with the feet, the legs, and the hips, and that is important, but also to include the eyes and the jaw is also important. So let's start off. You'll have fun with these. First one is you're going to look up and open your mouth as wide as you can comfortably. And you're just going to hold that for a couple of seconds. All right. That's a lot of fun. Now, what about working with the jaw? It's uncomfortable. Some people can't open their mouth very far. You do not do that to the point of discomfort, or if it's your jaw is clicking a lot, you don't want to make it click a lot and hurt or do anything that's really causing it to pull apart too far where it hurts. So this is for average pain-free movement to increase range of motion in the joint. Now that was the first one. And I'll just review that. We're going to open our eyes, open your mouth, look up. Okay, now we're going to have one where we look to one side. I'll use my fingers. I'm looking to one side. I'm moving my jaw in another direction to the opposite side. And then I'm going to reverse it. And then I'm going to reverse it. And then I'm going to reverse it. Okay, so I know some of you think that's pretty strange, and I actually teach many of my patients to do this in their cars at the traffic lights, so that when they see other people doing it, they know where they come to get therapy at. So it's very effective. It releases all of these muscles at the base of the skull, and it's very effective for working with the this whole region. So it just takes a little practice. Some people say they have problems with it, but essentially you start off by moving your eyes side to side. Just practice that. Okay, and then you start moving your jaw in the opposite direction to where your eyes are going. Very therapeutic. Okay, let's do another one. We're going to pretend that we have a pointer. So you would like a laser pointer coming out of your chin, and you're going to take that little pointer and draw little circles with your jaw. Okay, and let those little circles get a little bit bigger. Boy, isn't that fun. Now we're going to go the opposite direction. Little circles become bigger circles. Now, if you have good range of motion in your jaw and you're doing those exercises, that is actually, you're starting to feel blood come into the tissues, and the tissues start to relax and become more flexible. And so this is one thing you can do if you have TMJ problems that are not too severe. Well worth doing. So to review, we've done the look up and open the mouth and the eyes side to side with the jaw going the opposite direction. And we just did little circles, big circles going clockwise and counterclockwise. Now we're going to move the jaw in what we call the figure eight motion. Now we're going to start vertically, kind of like this. Okay, then we're going to reverse it and go the opposite direction. Okay, now that a lot of people find that to be a really strange sensation, but I can tell you that why that feels strange is because we don't do those activities very often. You ever see children going out into the grass or some other playground area or in a gymnastics class and doing a somersault, rolling over? And if we were as adults to get down and try to turn a somersault, we'd find that very cumbersome and very awkward because we've forgotten how to do that in our body. The same things with these motions is we develop a certain amount of they might be called sensory amnesia. That was a term that was invented by somatic therapists to talk about how we forget how to move our body, because what happens with repetitive motion, and particularly when we have our jobs and our tasks to do in life, we tend to do the same things over and over and over again, particularly in front of our body. And even though we are using our muscles and we think we're very active and you're very busy and you walk all these steps and all what have you, we're still using these muscles in limited ranges of motion, and so that's why they start tightening, particularly in this whole region from our head, face down to the inside of our arms. That's why we have all these problems here. So back to our jaw exercises. We're going to do horizontal figure eights. We just did vertical. Now we're going to do horizontal. Any help for you, can remember that as an infinity sign, and you're moving this way and that way. Okay, so our last jaw and facial exercise of that nature will be what we're going to do is a jaw jut, if you will. We're going to protract. We're going to push the jaw out like this. And what does that mean? We're pushing the bottom teeth in front of the top teeth. It really brings flexibility and looseness and retrains the jaw. Okay, now for some more fun, I know that you all enjoyed that. We're going to pull our ears. No, your ears are not going to get bigger. No, it's not going to hurt any of the tissues of any of you that have had any work around that area. So we're going to very gently traction our ears outward. You do this in a very light manner. You do not do it very hard. You do not pull very hard. It should feel good. I know some of you are laughing right now, but after you do this at home, you'll feel remarkably better. And in a way, this is kind of a self-cranial adjustment, as was the one where we're pulling down on our jaw with the myofascial stretch. Now we're going to do one more loosening technique for the back of the neck and the head, the muscles in the head. A lot of people don't realize that we have all these thin muscles that cover the top of our head, that and what's called a sheath of fascia. And like we have to raise our eyebrows, that's a good exercise. That actually is because there's very tiny muscles here. And what we're going to do is loosen them up by tapping on the back of our head, at the base of the skull and around the tops of the ears, and over the jaw a little bit. And as I was saying earlier, not only is this going to help your head and your jaw in the front of your neck in particular, but it's going to help the whole neck region, cervical region, down to the shoulders, down to the hands. And it might be kind of surprising to you to hear that some people, when I work on them, have carpal tunnel syndrome, that I actually have to massage their jaw muscles for their carpal tunnel pain to go away. It's very surprising. And of course, people say, well, what muscle is linked from your jaw to your hand? But there's a fascial connection and a nervous connection and a chain, a kinetic chain that moves through this whole region that's involved in tightening of the hands. So you might be surprised at what could happen there. Now, I know you enjoy those TMJ stretches. We'll do a few more, and we're going to do something utterly simple. We're going to do shoulder rolls. My goodness. You know what? People forget to do these things. And yes, this is a movement, but it does bring in loosening of this whole region. Okay, so we're like self-manipulating, if you will, self-mobilizing both directions, forward and backward, and then forward and backward. So now, another important factor is your spinal flexibility. So we're not going to do a whole yoga session, for instance. In fact, we're just going to do a little bit of spinal twisting, standing spinal twisting. So all of these things you can do in the office. So what does that mean? I'm turning my head as far as I can to one side, and I'm following it around the rest of my body as far as I can go so that I can look back behind me. Not hurt. Okay, some people will be limited in that range of motion. Turning my head this way, letting my eyes move, and looking behind me, and then coming back to the front. I'm just going to repeat that several times so you get an idea of what's going on. And over this way. And I can't tell you how good that feels. One more time, just because I like to do it, and it makes me feel good. And I do a lot of these same things myself, for my own self-care, because I'm always using my hands doing manual therapy and helping people stretch. Okay, now we're going to do the big finish, the finishing stretch. So a lot of people have forward head posture. We've talked a little bit about that. They do things in front of their body. They're keying in information. They're driving cars. They're using their hands in front of the body. Imagine that. And what happens is the head starts migrating forward. And then we see people that their heads are starting to migrate forward. Maybe that's us too. And as we get older, it's just because we start using these muscles in the front of our body to the exclusion of good extension movements going backwards. So I'm going to show you a little exercise slash stretch to help, you know, alleviate that and prevent that. So what we're going to do is I'm going to bend over from the waist with my knees slightly bent, look down at the floor, and I'm going to put my thumbs pointing to the back here, and then I'm going to straighten up slowly and point my thumbs around like this, rolling my shoulders out and tilting my head back and looking up at the ceiling. I'll repeat that again. I'm just going to point my thumbs to the back, and then I'm going to straighten up here. And that's another really good stretch for the forehead. Now, if any of you happen to do yoga, you might know the cobra pose. And of course, there's these therapeutic exercise balls one can use, and other movement therapies and stretches and many, but we're covering the basics. And most of what you have seen here today is what I teach people in my clinic to actually solve their problems and after they've had therapy to maintain pain-free living. So we'll talk about a few other things here in a moment, and I'll tell you how I work with carpal tunnel patients and people have pain in their arms and hands, what we call allied modalities. I hope you've enjoyed watching some of these stretches, but in addition to watching them, I hope you actually do them in your life. I think that you'll find them most beneficial. I thought I would talk about a few other things that I share with people who have hand and arm pain. Now, one of the things that I find very useful is ice therapy. A lot of people are not comfortable with ice therapy, but it's very effective. And one way I use it is to have people buy a plastic pitcher, and they'll put a tray of ice in the pitcher and fill it up with enough water to cover their wrist and hand, and you'll put your hand in the ice water. And usually I have people do this while they're at home watching TV or something in the evening when they don't have to do anything. And you know, the excuse is always, well, I don't have time to do this. Well, you always have time to do something like that when you're sitting down in the evening. And basically what's going to happen the first time you do this, you can stick your hand in a pitcher of ice water, it's going to be very cold. And what then happens is it's going to get so cold that you have to take your hand out. But after you do that, you'll notice that your hand warms up. And you want to do this with both hands, even though one hand may be painful or stiff, you want to do it with both hands anyway. It also increases the circulation to the forearms, and actually is very relaxing for the nervous system. So if you do it before you go to bed, it might actually help you relax and sleep better. So after you've stuck your hand in the ice water, you bring it out because it's too cold, the hand warms up, you stick it back in again. And you accumulate a few more seconds, maybe 30 more seconds. And so each time you do that, you keep track of the time by a clock, and so that you do it for 5 minutes total each time, for 5 minutes for each hand. So you'll take it out, warm it up, stick it back in. Now eventually, after you do this for a few weeks, you'll be able to leave it in for a total of 5 minutes without taking it out. And most people find out that they easily get used to it, and you're really kind of just just trying it and doing it, and over time your ability to leave your hands in there will increase. This is very good, and people have known about this kind of thing, in sports for a long time. People that have tendon injuries and what have you, this is a very effective therapy. People sometimes ask me, can't you use a cold pack? Cold pack's okay, but it's just not quite as effective. Okay, so I would encourage you to try that. It's very good when the tendons are inflamed, the muscles are inflamed. Let's go to hot therapy now. A lot of people like hot therapy better than cold therapy. The reason that cold is so effective is it moves blood away from the tissues and it brings new blood back into the tissues. It starts moving things. Heat is also good. It's usually good for more chronic conditions where you've had stiffness over a long period of time. But that brings blood to the tissues. The heat draws blood into the muscles and the tendons and ligaments and what have you. And then what happens is the blood will tend to stay there. Well, that's great if you're stiff. For instance, most people who are older, when they get up in the morning, they feel stiff. Or some people have had like an injury or you'll stiffen. Well, that's because most of the blood leaves the tissues at night and moves to the core of the body. That's why people feel stiff in the morning. And then it starts moving out of the tissues as you start moving, and then the stiffness goes away. So these are good things to know instead of just using over-the-counter anti-inflammatories. Those are okay, but I don't think we should live on those. I think those should be infrequent things that we use. But we probably know people who have used them on a daily basis for years, or perhaps we've done that ourselves. And I would encourage you trying some of these other things I'm mentioning. Now, one of the simplest heat therapies that you can do at home is to get a paraffin bath. So you can see I like immersion, sticking your limbs into something that is hot or cold and immersing it in there. And so a paraffin bath can probably be bought in one of the big box stores or one of the drug stores, chains. And it's liquid wax. You may have seen it at a physical therapist or a hand therapist, and you stick your hand in there and it feels really good. It's very hot. And you coat your arm in a layer of wax or paraffin. And if it's too hot, you want to take it out of there, but you can dip back in several times, get several coats, and leave it on for about 10 minutes. Also softens the skin really wonderfully. So you can do both of these therapies together. You can do hot and cold. Hot and cold is what I recommend. You can do one after another. It breaks up a lot of the what we call congestion in the tissues. Now, another way to do this is to do it at your sink. You might not want to stand at your sink, but if you wanted to do it for a minute or two instead of 5 minutes, you could put one sink full of ice water and one sink full of hot water, and then move your hands back and forth. You could do it like 30 seconds each, hot, cold for a few minutes, that kind of thing. So what about my hot pad? Well, hot pad is not moist. Yes, there are moist hot pads. I just like immersion better. Sometimes you can use a hot pack. Those are usually made with clay or some other material. Or sometimes there's things you can microwave. Those are okay. But the immersion, I recommend you try. I think they're very effective. So hot water, ice water, paraffin. Try some of those different ideas. Okay, so those are some of the modalities I would suggest to people for home self-care. Other things that I like are vitamin therapy. Now, this is a very safe regimen. In fact, I think it was developed by doctors back in the late 80s, early 90s. And it's not well known, but it's very effective. And that's using fairly good doses of vitamin C. And we're talking about getting something like a buffered vitamin C, which won't cause you any bowel distress. And you can take probably anywhere the amount of 6, 8 grams, 10 grams, which is about 10,000 milligrams of powdered vitamin C in a little juice or water. And usually you can find something that has a couple of grams per teaspoon, something like that. Very good for inflammation in addition to helping you ward off colds and flus and helping build your immune system. And also vitamin B therapy. You can take a broad range of Bs. Usually they come in units of 50 or 60. You can buy these things at the health food store. I try to send people to the health food store rather than the big box stores, the drug store chains, because they tend to have better quality vitamins. They tend to have vitamins that at the big box stores that aren't as high a quality. So, and how much you take of that? Well, whatever the recommended dosage is, so that you get 50 to 60 units. That's usually micrograms or milligrams of vitamin B. Now, vitamin B6 therapy is also very effective. That's in addition to the other B vitamins. And you take something like 100 to 200 milligrams of that a day. And to my knowledge, there's no side effects and there's no known harm for taking any of these things. And I've only seen people benefit from them. In fact, I've seen people with arm and hand pain only do vitamin therapy and do well. But I encourage you to use stretching and some of these ice and heat therapies. In other words, taken together, they're very effective. Your feet will have very stubborn hand pain, stubborn arm pain, shoulder pain, things that might not just resolve using the vitamin therapy. But it's a very good type of home self-care to do vitamin therapy when the arms and hands are stressed. I'll mention a little bit about herbal anti-inflammatories. Some of my favorites are marshmallow root and yucca. Usually you can buy them in capsules as powdered herbs and take them usually like two or three twice a day, something to that effect. Those seem to work very well. Of course, the other ones that people do fairly well are things like willow bark and meadow sweet, and of course ginger and turmeric are more known in the media and in the public. And they all work, and there's many more of them. And you may also want to try herbs like valerian, believe it or not, which works for the nervous system, helps calm down nervous irritation, what have you. So there's a lot of things that you use. They're all very safe, and they're sold over the counter. I've never seen anyone hurt from them. If you are taking medications, you do need to do a little bit of research and find out if there's interactions. Mostly there's not, but it still doesn't hurt to move around a little bit. Okay, then finally, we can talk about therapies by professionals, and I'll mention a couple of different things that are beneficial to people that have arm and hand and shoulder pain. One of the modalities that's fairly well out there in across America, North America, is neuromuscular therapy. It's a type of massage and manipulation. It's not just a massage, it's muscle specific, and works on the posture as well as the uses of the body, the regional aspects of the muscles we've been talking about. And for instance, connecting the neck down to the hand and releasing that area, musculoskeletal and nerve impingements. Also, myofascial release, which is a fairly common therapy in North America, United States. And that's sort of a stretching technique for the fascia throughout the whole body, and very effective for pain conditions. In fact, a lot of what yoga is stretching the fascia. These are sustained stretches over a period of time, stretches the fascia. That's why people feel so good when they do it. It moves fluid and balances the nervous system and helps the fascia stretch. In fact, there are people who do things called yoga therapy. So that's another modality you can look at. Finally, acupuncture is good for some people. More specific, I would say that you might want to do some combination of those therapies that I mentioned. If one of them doesn't work for you, you may need to try one of the other ones or find a different practitioner. Their practitioners are on all different levels. There's some that are excellent and have a good history of helping people in pain. Those are the ones you're looking for. Those people are usually busy, and you're looking for someone in your community that's usually someone who does that kind of work and is known for it and is effective, and other people know about it and are willing to recommend to you. Sometimes the Yellow Pages or the internet is effective for finding people like that, but you may have to try several people before you find the right one. Now, I don't want to imply that those are the only therapies that help people, but those are common ones that can be found through most of the United States and Canada, and are work really well for a lot of people. So we've just talked about a number of self-help modalities at home, several professional modalities, but once again, the subject of this tape is stretching. I think that if you begin to do these things, that you'll find them very effective, and I wish you luck on your journey towards health, and have a good day.